This clip is the lecture for the chapter 4 of the material testing. It's going to talk about the mechanical properties of materials. As you may recall, we start from chapter 1 in which we talking about how to write a good report. The good report is important because when you test the material, the report will use at least for the civil engineer in two ways. First, for the approval of the acceptance of the material when you work in the sites, construction sites. Or another way, the report is used to support the reliability of the material for the production in a company like Siam Cement Group. And then we talking about how we analyze the data properly. For example, when you work for the construction site, you may test the concrete for every 50 cubic meter. And then you do just 3 tests for each batch of the concrete. And you're going to use simple calculation like the mean, like a standard deviation. If all the test results pass the specification, that material are acceptable. But if you work for a big company for manufacturing like a steel, and then you like to guarantee your production, that means you're going to test a lot of specimen and calculation for the mean, for the standard deviation, for the coefficient of variation. And you also need to analyze the reliability of the mechanical property that you use to guarantee that your production are very reliable. For example, you use the mean minus 4 standard deviation, so your product will be 99.99 something reliable percent. Okay, and then we talking about how we decide the test. We supposed to select a proper machine, testing machine, a proper measuring device to reduce the error that may have in our test. We also consider, like for the steel, we need to do the tension more than the compression, because the steel usually used to resist the tensile force, for example, in the reinforced concrete. Also, the concrete, we usually test the concrete in compression because most of the concrete in compression. And we also talking about different variables when we design the test. For example, if we work for the aerospace company, the test of the best material need to be very accurate, since the design of the airplane use the factor of safety of only 1.1 or 1.2. But for the civil engineer, we use larger factor of safety, at least 2.0, and then the margin of safety are larger, and then we may need to use less accuracy compared to the test of the aerospace material. Okay, the objective of learning or learning objective. First, we would like you to understand the stress-strain diagram of material and be able to find the mechanical property of the material. If you may recall from the chapter 3 of mechanics of material, we calculate the normal stress from the result of tension test. We measure the force applied to the specimen, and then we divide it by the area. We also measure the elongation of that force, and then divided by original gate length. So we got the stress and strain. We put the stress in the vertical direction, and we put the strain in the horizontal direction. we call that stress strain diagram. For the stress strain diagram, we also can read it and take some important mechanical property. For example, following the Thai Industrial Standard TIS, when you do the specification for the reinforcing steel, you need to take the yielding stress, you need to take the ultimate stress, you also need to take the modulus of elasticity. Those mechanical property of the material are or must be larger than the given in the specification. For example, if the specification said this reinforcing steel should have at least 2,400 kilogram per square centimeter or 250 megapascal, and then you test or you test result get 280, 270, and 260, that are above the specific value in the specification that are acceptable. Okay, and some other important property that we may calculate from the stress strain diagram, such as the modulus of resilience, the modulus of rupture, the fracture stress. Okay, and second, we like you to understand the Hooke's law. Hooke's law is really important law because when we design the structure, we put the yielding stress and divide it by factor of safety to get the allowable stress. We design based on allowable stress. That means we design based on when the behavior of the material is in linear elastic. And during the linear elastic, the stress strain relationship is linear. The equation is normal stress equal to modulus of elasticity times strain. Okay, and the modulus of elasticity is the slope of the stress strain diagram during the linear elastic behavior. And for a material, the E always equal. For example, for the low strength steel and medium strength steel and the high strength steel all have the same modulus of elasticity. The third, you should be able to determine the deformation of the structural member. For example, you have a column in the building and the column subjected to the force from the roof from the second floor. So the column going to have two portions. One is AB for the first floor, another one for the BC, and then you can determine that deformation. And the deformation can be based on the behavior of the material. For example, for the elastic behavior, when the structure subjected to the force and the stress is less than the yielding, and when it has deformation, and then you take the force out, the structure will recover to its original length. However, for the structural member that has plastic behavior, okay, when it's deformed and you take the force out, the deformation will recover some, and the less going to be the permanent set for the structure and make the structure lost its function if the permanent set is too large. Okay, and the fourth, we like you to understand the failure of the material due to creep. Okay, creep may be occur in the concrete, is the permanent deformation of the concrete, because the concrete composed of cement, water, soil, sand, and crushed stone. When you mix this, there are some water in the concrete that are in the void. And then when you compress this, the water in the void just go out, and then the concrete has permanent deformation. And also we're talking about fatigue. Fatigue is some kind of the failure of the ductile material in the brittle manner, in which the structure subjected to the repeated load. For example, the bleach. You have steel bleach. The bleach will deform every time the vehicle passes, especially large vehicles such as 10-wheeler or 18-wheeler. And then it's going to go deform and rebound, deform and rebound, deform and rebound like this. For some design, if you do it improperly, the repeated stress may produce the crack in the steel and make the bridge abruptly collapse, and this may cause a lot of life or big accident. Okay, and didn't mention here, we also going to talking about the relaxation of the steel, especially the steel used in the prestressed concrete structure. Okay, this is the introduction of the chapter 4. And let's start the 4.1. We talking about the stress and strains. The stress at a point, if you have a structure, let's say, as shown in picture A, and then it's subjected to F1, the force, F2, and then you may cut the structure at a given section, and then you may use the free body, you may draw the free body diagram and use the equation of equilibrium to determine the resultant force and the resultant moment acting on the structure. Okay, and this is the engine static. But when you consider the force that act on every point on the structure in the picture B, and then if you consider the force divided by the area, that's going to be the stress. Okay, and the stress at the point of a structure defined by the intensity of the internal force on the specific area passing to that point. In the reality, for example, if you pull your finger, okay, your finger will be elongated and you will feel some tense in your finger and also feel something in your bone. That means your finger and your tissue and your bone get the stress. So actually, when the structure subjected to the external force is produce the stress to balance the force. But for the easy way of the engineering, we use the free body diagram and determine the force, the resultant force and resultant moment, and then we convert it into the stress. Okay, that is in the leg way. The leg way is in the real world. When you pull your finger, you feel what happened in your finger. That's due to the stress. So the resultant force and moment would be there. But for the engine calculation, we need to put one more step to determine the stress. We put the drawing of free body diagram and use the equation of equilibrium to find the force and moment. And then we end the in static. We move to the mechanics of material in figure B. Okay, and also the force is the intensity, so the force has the unit, the stress is the intensity, so the stress is the force divided by the area. So the unit of the stress is gonna be like 10 power 6 newton per square meter, or is also equal to newton per square meter. Or in Thai, sometimes in the design, we use kilogram per square centimeter or KSC. Okay. Finally, for this slide, all the force or the small area, the force can project into the axis that's parallel to the surface. Okay, that's called the tangential force, delta F sub T. T is tangential, And also there is a component of the force perpendicular to the area. That's called the normal force. That is delta F sub N. The normal force will provide the normal stress. Okay, the normal force divided by A is the normal stress. The tangential force may call the shear force. When divided by the area, we call it shear stress. Okay, next slide. We consider a rod, a steel rod, subjected to the force P. And then when we cut it, okay, at the half, you will get the free body diagram of the rod. Okay, and the free body, from the free body diagram, you will see the stress, sorry, the normal force inside this going to be the force here, and the force P here can be used to compute the normal stress that's acting on this whole section. Okay, and by the definition, the normal stress we call sigma is the intensity of the internal normal force over a small area, and when the force is in compression, it's going to produce the compressive stress. If it's in tension, like you pull your finger out, that is going to produce tensile stress. This structural member that's subjected to only the normal stress is the two force member, and you can find the two force member in the truss. Okay, it can be in tension, and it also can be in compression. The tension produce the tensile stress, the compression produce the compressive stress, and the equation is simple, like it's shown here. It's just the force divided by the area. Okay, next, you have the force that's parallel to the surface, the tangential force, or it can call shear force. Shear force produce the shear stress. Okay, the shear stress is defined as the intensity of the internal shear force over a small area. For example, here it's going to be tau equal to phi over A. Okay, and then if per se V is equal to 100,000 newton. Okay, it is equal to 100,000 newton, and then it's going to divide by the area of what? You can see from the picture, the area that's the force act is going to be this length of 100, and this is going to be 75, so it's going to be 100 millimeter times 75. So if this is a newton, okay, you may put this for 100 and then times 75, that's going to be millimeter square, and you also know that the millimeter newton per millimeter square is the mega pascal, and if you divide this, you will get this one. Cut is going to be 1,000 divided by 75, and if you put it into your calculator, it's going to be very easy. 1,000 divided by 75 is 13.33. That is going to be the shear stress acting on this. It's going to be 13.33 megapascal. Okay, and also from the previous slide, was like if you define this force of 10 kilonewton, no, 10 kilonewton, you also can determine the stress that occur in this rod to be 10 kilonewton, and then divided by 10 kilonewton is 10,000 newton, and then you divide this one by, for example, 0.01 meter square. Okay, and then you're going to get this for what? That is going to be get 2 more 0 by divided by 0.01. So you're going to get this one 10^0 newton per square meter, and you may have this for 1 megapascal. This is 1 megapascal. Okay, it's very simple to determine the stress. Just directly divide this stress by this force by the area. This is normal stress and shear stress. Okay. And then we have many equations during the course of mechanical or during the course of mechanics of material. First chapter, we're talking about the axial force, and the axial force produces the axial stress. Okay, the axial stress is called the normal stress. It's the force divided by area. And also, if you pull, for example, the rubber band, and then you calculate the normal stress. The rubber band also elongate. You can calculate the normal strain by putting the elongation divided by the length. And if the material is linear elastic, okay, that's going to be chapter 1, if you recall, chapter 2, and then chapter 3, you have the Hooke's law. And then you put the stress into this equation, you're going to get what? P over A equal to E and elongation or contraction divided by L. So you're going to get what? Delta equal to PL, delta equal to PL over EA. That's going to be for chapter 4. Okay. And also chapter 1, you have the direct shear. Direct shear may occur at the support. Okay, it can be single shear and it can be double shear. That's going to be tau equal to V over A. We also have the shear stress in chapter 5 of mechanics of material when the structural member subjected to the torsion. The T is going to be the torsion, okay? And mostly it occurs in the shaft, and you can see the shaft in the truck, okay? That's transfer the torsion from the engine to the rear view of the truck. In an issue engineer, we also use the shaft, for example, to dig up the soil, to bore the rock, okay? And you're going to determine the shear stress due to that torsion. And for the torsion, you also has the tau equal to G gamma. That is the relationship between the shear stress equal to the shear modulus of elasticity times the shear strain. Okay. Remark, the shear strain is in radian, the unit of the shear strain. And finally, we also compute the angle of twist of the shaft. The angle of twist is equal to TL divided by GJ, when J is going to be polar moment of inertia. Okay, for the square section, the J polar moment of inertia is equal to I sub X plus I sub Y. And since for the rectangle, for the square section, hollow section, sorry, not square section, for the hollow section or the circular section, the I sub X equal to I sub Y. So the J for the square section is going to be 2 times the moment of inertia. And then the structure, move to chapter 6 and chapter 7, the structure subjected to bending and the shear force. That structure such as beam and frame, okay, and you can determine the normal stress due to the bending of the moment, okay, and you also calculate the transverse shear stress or to due to the transverse shear. And if the beam are the built up section, that means it may built by putting two pieces of wood together, and if you use the nail or bolt to connect them, you need to calculate the shear flow also. Okay, this is a lot whole of equation that we have in the mechanics of material that we can use this to calculate the stress in some simple structure such as a shaft, such as the beam and frame, okay. And next, when you pull the rubber band have stress, the rubber band also elongate, okay. And if you divide the elongation by the original length, D, you calculate the strain. The strain is defined as something that indicates the deformation of the material due to the apparent stress. For example, you have the cable link between BC, its original length is 2L, and when you pull it, okay, the B move to B prime, and then you have some elongation between B and B prime, okay, and if you divide this elongation by 2L, you will get the normal strain. The normal strain can be elongation for structure tension or contraction if the structure is in compression and the unit of strain is going to be length. Okay, this is the delta here, and divided by original length, so it can be meter per meter or millimeter per millimeter, okay. If you can put this from the picture, you may have the length between B prime and C. This is after the deformation, you got to minus the length between BC, and then you're gonna divide this deformation by the length BC, which is 2L. Okay, and then we move to the shear strain. When the structure is subjected to torsion, what it has is, if you mark the square on the surface of the shaft, and when the shaft subjected to the tau equal to TR over J, the square will change the shape to the new one like this, and then the angle, okay, between the size of the square element will change from pi over 2 to theta prime, and then if you minus pi over 2 with theta prime, you get the shear strain, okay, and then the shear strain have unit of the radian. The shear strain can be both sides, one with the y-axis, another one with the x-axis. So shear strain is defined as the change of angle that occurs between two line segments or two sides, which originally normal to one another under the applied force. Okay, and One more example that occur in the rubber shaft. You also can take a look at this. We studying this in the chapter 5 of the mechanics of material. Okay, now we know normal stress and normal strain. It can be by the tensile force, or it can be by the compressive force. And then you may have the relationship between them, sigma normal stress equal to E times epsilon. Epsilon is normal strain. The E is modulus of elasticity. You also have the tau shear stress and gamma shear strain. And then you have previously tau equal to G gamma for the linear elastic part of the shaft under the twist. Okay, and now let's we go in depth with the normal stress, the normal strain diagram for the 4.2. We can draw the shear stress. We can draw the normal stress, normal strain by diagram by the tensile test. Okay, we do the tension test. We put the specimen in the axial force. It can be by the tension or by the compression like this, and you can compute the stress, and then you compute the strain as we mentioned before, and by using the what's so called the UTM, universal testing machine, you may read the load from the load scale. Nowadays this load scale is in digital already, not in something like this. And when you put the specimen into the position, you can measure the elongation by some devices such as the linear variable differential transducer or the LVDT. You may put LVDT in the Google. It's going to tell you a lot about that device. You may put like LVDT, linear variable differential transducer, that measure the elongation and or the contraction. For the force, you may put the word load, LOADD, load cell. Cell. Okay, it's going to you can do further study by Google this kind of thing. This provides the elongation, contraction, this provides force. Okay, when you get the force, the load gonna divide by the area, and then you get the stress and the elongation divided by original length, you got the strain. And then you put the stress strain in the graph, and you get this graph. The vertical axis is the normal stress. Usually the value of this normal stress is large, okay, and the horizontal axis is going to be the normal strain. Usually the value is small, okay, and when you put this whole data into the graph, you may get the scale that's kind of not so detailed. It's going to be rough scale. The problem is when you put everything into the graph, the first portion of the stress strain diagram, which show the linear elastic part, is very close to the vertical axis. And then we are not clear what going to be there. So usually we also draw another graph for the first portion of the stress strain diagram by using a more detailed scale, like the one that we use below this. And you may recall the ratio of the scale gonna be 0.1 divided by 0.001, that's going to be a 100 times scale. Okay, that is 100 times scale, like you soup it in 100 times. And then you may see the first portion of the graph clearer. Okay, and first part is linear. Okay, and also from this first part, you also find some important mechanical property that's specified in the Thai industrial standard for the structural steel and for the reinforcing steel. That is the yield stress. And also yield stress supposed to be here. Okay, yield stress supposed to be here. And also you can be able to determine this. This is going to be the modulus of elasticity, which is going to be the delta stress divided by the delta strain. Okay, I should note that the Thai industrial standard require 4 parameters for the specification of structural steel and reinforcing steel. One is yielding stress, like I mentioned here. Second is modulus of elasticity, and the third is going to be the what's so called the ultimate stress. Okay, the sigma sub u, and the other one is the percent elongation. We will be talking about the elongation later. Okay, this is an example of the stress strain diagram for the mild steel. Okay, mild steel. We use mild steel as structural steel. Okay, and then we have at least three important mechanical property. One from the large scale or rough scale, and another one for the finer scale. Okay, and this is an example that I'm talking about the structural section for the TIS. Sorry for this, the TIS 116.2529. They require us to check if the steel is in accordance with the Fe24 grade. This is great. The yielding stress for this must be at least 2400 for yielding stress, 4100 for the ultimate stress, and 23% for the percent elongation, and 200,000 KSC for the modulus of elasticity. If you take the specimen from a million baht steel that you buy, and you find some of the specimen won't pass this mechanical property, what are you going to do? Usually, you need to send the steel back to the manufacturer to ask them to send the new steel that have a proper mechanical property. You're going to buy a million baht merchandise, you're going to get at least 1 million baht thing. Okay, and next, let us consider the model of the engineering stress strain diagram, and we are going to learn the portion of the stress strain diagram, what the definition of different thing in this diagram. I should say that stress strain diagram of a material is some kind of a signature of that material. Most of the material have its own characteristics, such as if you consider this is the stress strain diagram for ductile material. Okay, in the last picture we have two big type of material. One is ductile material, another one is brittle material. Ductile material is the material that can deform a lot, such as structural steel. Structural steel is a kind of ductile material, okay? And another one is the brittle material. Brittle material is material that has less deformation when it's failed, such as concrete, such as rock, okay, it's deformed less. And for this material, for ductile material, mainly can classify the behavior of the material into two types. One is elastic behavior. The elastic behavior occurs in the first portion of its stress strain diagram. By the elastic behavior, what it means is when you pull the material by the force, it's made from 10 millimeter. And then when you release the force, the deformation return back, you get your original length. That's elastic behavior. And another one is the plastic behavior. The elastic behavior, you may pull the rubber band and release it. For the plastic behavior, you may find some plastic bag and then cut it into some rectangular specimen. And if you pull it slowly, the first part of it's going to be elastic behavior. And if you put force larger and larger, the plastic band gonna have large deformation, and you can see some change on its material. And when you release the force, part of the deformation will return, and another part will be the permanent set. This is a kind of plastic behavior, okay? In our aging life, mostly we involve with elastic behavior because most of our structure when subjected to the force is deform very small. And when the force move out, it's going to rebound back, okay? And also, if we consider closer in the elastic behavior, we call it the elastic region, there is some interporting point, okay? When the force increase, the relationship between the stress strain in this region is linear. And the last point, the linear behavior can be found is the proportional limit point, okay? And this called the proportional limit stress is the theoretical stress. That's the Hooke's law is true, okay? And if you increase the force a little bit more, the graph is curved and reach the last point of elastic region. We call this elastic limit. At the elastic limit, it's going to be very close to the start of the yielding behavior. What is the yielding behavior? You may see at this point, okay, the curve is horizontally. The slope here is zero. When the slope is zero, what it mean? The structure change its shape without increase the stress. The stress here is the yield stress, one of the very important stress in the design of the structure. What happened at this point when the steel produce, okay, the ingot put into a high temperature and the solid ingot just melt and you put some specific additive into that melt ingot, and then you pull it into the production line, and you may produce the steel with various structural sections. And during the cool down from the liquid status into the solid status, the steel forms some grain, and the grain forming is random, is naturally occur, okay? And when the steel put into the stress of yielding stress, the grain of the steel start to move and rearrange itself to be a more systematic manner. By doing that, what we have is the strain of the elongation of the material and produce the constant stress with increasing large increase, 20 times or 30 times increase in the strain. Since the increase with increase of the deformation without increase of the stress on force, that's why engineers use the yielding stress as the strength of the material, and then we divide the yielding stress with some factor of safety to limit the use of the strength to be in only in the linear elastic region here. So in reality, the civil engineering structure gonna respond to the force within only this small length compared to the whole big picture. Okay, and then at the end of yielding region, the grain of the structure compact and it start to take more force and the stress start to moving up again higher and higher. This part of the steel called the strain hardening. The strain hardening is mean is hardened by the strain. By strain what? By the strain in the yielding region. The grain is more complex systematically and it start to harden, taking more force. And this region end up when the stress occur in the material get the highest point, which called the ultimate stress. Okay, and then we got the stress here of sigma sub u, and sigma sub u is the one that property of the Thai industrial standard require us to test for. After that, you can see the specimen section start to have neck. Okay, the necking occur after the ultimate stress. Actually, necking occur before, but it's clearly see after the ultimate stress. You can see during perform the lab. Okay, and the stress now drop down due to the when it's cause necking, the area that take the force just get lesser and lesser. And then the sequence separate into two pieces as the fracture point. Some Ajahn call it rupture point. Okay, it can be fracture stress or rupture stress. It's okay. It's both. It's okay. Okay, this is necking that I mentioned before the failure of the ductile material. Okay, and the area reduced. See. And that's why the curve just come downward. This is a clear picture of necking and a clear picture of two separate pieces of specimen after failure. And this is another, again, this is again the stress strain diagram of the mild steel that we visited before. And now we supposed to take some important mechanical property from the graph. As we may see, there is two graphs here. The phi graph use this lower scale, and the left graph, the top graph, above graph, use the above scale, and the phi scale provides us the proportional limit stress, our upper yield stress. and lower yield stress. These three stresses are close to each other, and as I mentioned before, engineers use the yielding and use the lower yielding. They use the lower yielding because the lower yielding is defined clearly, okay, and it's a little bit lower than the upper yielding. And upper yielding is just a point. There is not a stable value. So engineer select the lower yielding, okay, in the design. And why don't they use the sigma proportion? Because the Hooke's law follow the sigma proportion. Since the yielding and the proportion is so close, okay. So many times we find the sigma proportion harder because we got to put the ruler along the linear line and take a look when the line separate from the curve. Okay, that's going to depend on the eye of the people. So the definition of sigma sub PL is weak. Okay, they didn't use the sigma sub PL, and since it's close to sigma sub yielding, they just select sigma sub yielding, and they also use the factor of safety of 2 also. So we just select the yielding as our engineering strength of the steel. Strength, okay, it's called strength, STRENGTH is the ability of the material that can take the applied force, okay, without its failure. And also you can find the other property, that is the modulus of elasticity from this graph. Okay, that is the second important thing. And the third thing is the ultimate stress. This is also important for the Thai industrial standards of specification for the steel, and also the fracture stress. Okay, and also you can determine the strength at the proportion. And then if you know the sigma sub PL, and also you know the strength sub PL proportional strength, you can find the area, okay, under this. What's the area under this? It's going to be the modulus of resilience, okay, the ability of the material that can take the energy without permanent deformation. And you also can find the yielding strength, and it's important to note that the yielding strength measure at the end of yielding region. The yield stress measure at the start of the yielding region. So you may notice that strength at the end of the yielding region is considerably larger than the strength at the beginning. That's sure. It's going to be 0.003, and strength at the beginning is going to be like approximately, if you go down here, okay, it can be about 0.014, 0.015. That means it's 20 times larger, okay, and it said thus the design code specify the yielding stress is the strength of the steel. Since beyond this stress, the steel deform significantly, and the structure cannot function as designed. Okay, that's the reason. That's why we use that. And we also have the strain as fracture. It's going to be very large. You can see point oh three eight. Okay, and compared to the strain at the yielding of only 0.015. So this means when you use the structure, actually the structure gonna have very small deformation. Whenever if you take a look the structure, and structure start to have very large deformation, this means the structure tend to fail. You got to move from the building, okay. Okay, next, we consider the failure of the steel and the cast iron. When you test the steel and you bleed from the glove, the steel is the ductile material. Before it fails, it has the necking effect. Okay, by the necking effect, you can see this failure gonna have shape like this. What happened during the necking? During the necking, the grain of the steel were move or slipping, okay, due to the shear stress. It's very strange. The structure subjected to the tension, okay, but the failure is due to the shear stress. Yes, it occur because the structural steel have small shear strength compared to the normal strength. That's why it select to fail by the shear stress. And the evidence is the 45 degree failure, okay, as the necking. However, for the cast iron is the steel with more carbon to improve the stiffness, to improve the hardness of the surface of the cast iron, and is used for the layout of the train to taking the force from the steel wheel. Okay, when the steel wheel of the train touch the rail, is going to put large compression into it. Okay, and when the train break, there is large amount of shear force applied to the surface of the steel. Okay, and since the surface of the cast, since the surface of the cast iron is so strong, so that's what won't harm the surface of the cast iron. If it is the structural steel, the structural steel will deform a lot due to the force from the train break. And then the failure of the cast iron is like this, okay, is just in the normal to the axis of the specimen. Why? Because the carbon, when you put into the steel, carbon and steel have some micro crack. When it's subject to tension, the micro crack open, and then only small, and then it's going to crack, and then the crack going to be really large, go really large, really quick, really large, and then the area that resists the force gets smaller and smaller, and then they separate by the tensile stress, and the failure plane is 90 degrees to the longitude axis of the test specimen, like this. Okay, it's really strange. They have different failure. Okay, next. Sorry, it's going to be 4.3. I don't know. This is number is wrong. Okay, the ductile and brittle material. Ductile material is a kind of structural steel. It can deform a lot because before its failure. And the Thai industrial standard TS specify the fourth factor about the percent elongation of the steel. At least the steel supposed to have more than 20% before its failure. That means the Thai industrial standards specify the steel with very high ductility. So the steel is a kind of ductile material. Okay, since it can deform considerably, it's also the ductile material also can absorb really large amount of energy. That means when you design the guard rail of the bridge, usually we won't use wood because when the tug hits the wood absorbs less energy. The wood guardrail can be broken into many pieces and the tug may drop from the bridge to the water or to the ground. Okay, that's going to be very bad accident. However, if you have steel, when the tug hits the steel guardrail, the steel guardrail can take the force from the tug and it won't break into two pieces. The tug won't fall down from the bridge. Also, you can build the guardrail with the concrete, okay, by some design. Because the concrete reinforced with the steel is also can absorb large amount of energy. Next, we have the brittle material. Brittle material is kind of a rock, a cast iron, concrete. Okay, it's heavily small deformation when it's failure. Okay, talking about the person elongation, we have the steel specimen and we also have the gate length. Okay, the gate length is the original length of the material. And then you test the specimen until it fails. And then you may lower the clips, and then your crack on the specimen can be connected, and you can measure the new length after the failure. We let's call this one as the L as the failure, L sub F. And then if you put the L sub F into this, okay, let's say if the L sub F is going to be 60 millimeter, you're going to have this one of what equal to 10. 60 minus 50 is 10 divided by 50. And then if you time it by 100%, you can get this one for 20%. Okay, that's its example. And another factor is 12% area reduction or percent reduction of area. The same thing, before you test the specimen, you measure the diameter. This is going to be calculated to be the original area. And after the failure of specimen, you can measure the D sub F. Okay, this is going to be the failure diameter, and then you also can calculate A sub F. Okay, and when you determine this, most of the structural steel will have the percent reduction of the area more than 50%, some are 60 something percent. Okay, next, let's talk about some special material that do not have the yielding, such as aluminum alloy, such as the high strength steel. Okay, that is some specific material that won't have the yielding. When the structure have no yielding, some industrial standards such as the STM specify to use the 0.2% offset to determine the yielding of that material. By the 0.2%, that means you're going to divide 0.2 by 100. So when you divide this, you will get the strength of 0.002. And then you mark this 0.002. And then you draw the line parallel to the linear length. And then when it cut the point, this point going to be the yielding stress of this material. Okay, it's important to know that this is the example for the aluminum alloy. And coming to the brittle material that has low tensile strength and very high compressive strength, again, when the cast iron, for example, okay, is subjected to tension, the micro crack in the cast iron will open and go up rapidly, so that the area that resists the force reduce considerably, and then it fail immediately or abruptly. However, in the opposite direction, when the cation is in compression, the macrophage close to each other, and also due to the Poisson ratio, the size of the specimen get bulk out. Okay, it get larger. So most of the brittle material can take very large compression. Okay, due to that two effect, closing of the macrophage and lateral deformation due to the Poisson ratio, and we have larger area to take the compression. Okay, and this is also an example of the concrete. Okay, and these are the list the lesson that I just mentioned about it. And now this test in again for various material that we mentioned before, and we can see the on the like this is the test in tension, and for this lower left is the test in compression. By selecting from the chapter 3, the tension test or compression test is depend what we are going to use that material. Most of the concrete and the cast iron, they are used to resist the compression. So most of them test in compression tests. And why they are used in compression? Because they have high compressive strength. Also materials such as the low carbon steel, aluminum alloy, most of them used in tension. And also they have the same property both in tension and compression. And the tension test is also more easier to do. So most of them are tests in tension. And recall back from this stress strain diagram, which material have the highest strength? Remember? Which material have the lowest strength? Which material have the highest stiffness? Which material have the lowest stiffness? Which material is the ductile material? Which material are the ductile material? Which material are the brittle material? That's a lot of questions that can be asked from this curve. Okay, let's you recall this. Okay, next, supposed to be 4, not 3. We are talking about the Hooke's law. Hooke noticed that the stress is linearly proportional to strain up to the proportional limit for a specific material such as the steel. The stress of the steel proportional to the strain. They are independent from the type of the steel. The lower carbon steel, the higher carbon steel all have the same slope. That means the modulus of elasticity is a kind of characteristic of a given material. Okay, it's not depend on the percent of carbon you put into the steel. And it can be like at the sigma equal to E times epsilon. And then you can determine E by what? By determine the delta sigma here. And also delta epsilon here. Okay, for the steel, the modulus of elasticity E is going to be about 200 gigapascal or 200,000 KSC. Okay, and sometimes this called the Young modulus. Okay, is the slope of the stress strain curve during the linear elastic region, and it indicates the stiffness of the material. From the previous graph, you can see that steel has the highest stiffness material in the graph, and the aluminium have the second, and the rubber have the less stiffness. Next, we consider the strain hardening. Strain hardening is a kind of material of some ductile material. Okay, when the material has a high stress and go beyond the elastic region OA to the plastic region over here, let's say this is the A pump, and when you release the stress will not go back by the initial route. Okay, it's going to go back like this, and it means it's go back parallel to its linear region, and then you are going to have the new graph when you reload it. Okay, this is going to be the new graph of this material. Okay, the strain that's recover is called recovery strain, and the strain that's still there is called permanent set, and then the new graph is going to be like this. What happened to this? What happened? You got the new graph. With the new graph, you got the higher strength from the previous one. You get the strength at this point, the light blue, and the new one, you get the new strength at A bar. Okay, and you also have the higher modulus of resilience. But your material is more brittle. Before that, it can deform like this. But after that, the deformation reduced to this. Okay, and also your modulus of rupture get lesser. The area under the graph. Talking about the strain energy. Okay, the strain energy is energy that's stored in the material. You can prove by bend your ruler, and then when you release the ruler, go back due to the elastic behavior. It can go back because it stored the energy inside it. Okay, when you release the external force, the energy release back. By consider the small material here with the dimension of C in the vertical direction, the delta Y and delta X. Okay, if you time the delta X by the delta Y, you're going to get the cross-sectional area. Okay, the delta Y time the delta X, you got the cross-sectional area. And if you plot the force and elongation curve during the linear elastic region, the response is going to be this. The area under the graph going to be the energy, okay, energy stored in the material, and that energy is going to be 1/2 of the delta P. Delta P is here, okay, and time the elongation. And what we have is sigma equal to P over A, and then you have P equal to sigma A, and the A is the green area, which is delta X times delta Y. You got this. And for the strain, okay, you have the strain equal to the deformation divided by delta C, and if you like it, you got the strain in this form. And you put the strain here, you put the delta P here, you got this new equation. After you time delta X, delta Y by delta Z, you got delta V. And the author is 1/2 of the stress times strain, which is the area under the stress strain diagram during the linear elastic region. And when you divide the energy by the volume, you got the state energy density, which is a form like this. And if the stress is maximum as proportional limit, and the strain also maximum as the proportional limit, you will get the next slide, the modulus of resilience, which is the ability of the material that can absorb energy without permanent deformation, okay, which is 1/2 of sigma proportion to the strain proportion. We also have another one, is modulus of elasticity. But see, the modulus of elasticity is the total area under the stress strain diagram. The way to calculate it, we only can approximate it. This is sigma sub y. This is sigma sub ultimate. Okay, and then you plus and divide by 2. You got this term. This term is the height of this. And then you times the height of this with the fracture strain. Okay, you got the yellow area. That's going to be the approximation of the modulus of toughness. That is ability of the material that can absorb energy before its failure. It is good. It's going to be high value. It's going to be good to build the guardrail. And then some important mechanical property of some etching material show here, the E of the aluminum, approximately here for the concrete, about this for the steel is the highest, okay, nearly 10 times the concrete. And for the wood, it's going to be about 10 less than the concrete. So the steel have the highest stiffness, okay, and the second supposed to be aluminum, and the third cast iron, okay, and the fifth is the concrete, and the last one is the wood. For the yielding, okay, yielding, for the yielding, you have the, it is depend on the grade, okay, of the aluminum. This is for the 2014 T6. This is for the 60-61, okay, and for the steel, this is based on American ASTM, okay, and stainless steel is lesser, and the Poisson ratio is there for the steel is about between 0.27 and 0.32. Aluminium is larger, about 0.35, okay, and the concrete is about 0.15. And the G is the shear modulus of elasticity. And another important, sorry, forget it, is the ultimate strength, sigma sub U. Okay, this is the first part of chapter 4. I like you to recall what you have for the mechanics of material. On chapter 3, we're talking about the properties of the material. The property of material can be determined by testing the material, such as the tensile test. And then you can plot the stress strain diagram. From the stress strain diagram, it explains you how the material behaves under the force. It can be elastic behavior, it can be plastic behavior. And for some ductile material, stress strain diagram can separate into another 4 regions. One is elastic, second is yielding, the third is strain hardening, and the last one is necking. And then we need to find at least 3 important mechanical properties according to the Thai industrial standard, which is yielding stress, ultimate stress, and modulus of elasticity. And also the fourth important mechanical property is the ductility of the material, which represented by the percent elongation of the material. And then we're talking about the Hooke's law, which is the stress equal to modulus of elasticity times strain. is only collects for the linear elastic, and then we use the Hooke law until the yielding, because the yielding is more clear defined, is more clearer defined compared to the proportional limit, and those two properties are very close. And then after the yielding, there are too much deformation. So the engineering use the yielding stress at the strength of the material and use the make the worst of elasticity at the stiffness. Okay, that's it. Next, we will talking about some important example in the next clip. Okay.